brought your Bible this morning. Thank you for being here. By the way, I appreciate Brother Lucy Hill playing for us this morning. Mrs. Bollinger, kids are sick, so that's why they're here this morning. Samuel chapter number 16. You'll locate verse number 7. I will read out loud on your assignment as we do in our church. If you read along with me. 1 Samuel chapter number 16, verse number 7. But the Lord said unto Samuel, look not on his countenance, nor on the height of his stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord seeth not as man seeth. He's going to get to the first. For man looketh. I'm just telling you right now, I agree. Getting old is for old people. I don't like it. But how many of you in this church or this room have ever been able to look into the heart of another person and say, who is that? Have you ever looked into the heart of another person and said, you read their heart and you knew for sure it was looking. How many have ever looked at another person and said, you know, your husband, go, I know what you're thinking, right? And know me, you only say that word they. When it's good, they go, they don't go to kiss. I don't know what you're thinking. They don't do that. But when it's bad, they go, I don't know, I know what you're thinking. I know what you're up to. And we tend to do this all the time. I have a question for you. Where are you looking at? Where are you looking at? Have you ever heard, or maybe you say to yourself, the Lord is more concerned about my outward appearance. The Lord is more concerned about my heart than my outward appearance. That's sweeping Christianity, right? We say this all the time. We make statements like that all the time. God is more concerned about my heart than the way I look or dress or where I go. Hey, the Lord knows my heart. And you'd be exactly right. The Lord does know your heart. That is an absolute Bible statement, so it has to be true. But the Lord does know your heart. Well, all of this is right, and the Lord does know your heart. But though the Lord looketh upon the heart, does not say that God is not concerned about the exterior of your life. Now, follow me very carefully. Back during the days of the Lord, we had not only brother Usher, but the Lord on the middle stage. All hippies would flip their hair. They would make a statement that God would not be there. And preachers didn't know what to do because it's a true statement. But man looketh upon the outward appearance. Now, how many of you right now are living in heaven with God? I'm not talking spiritually. No, nobody. We live on this earth among men, right? I'm trying to reason with you now. Follow me, okay? So we live among men. Jesus in heaven. I said, Jesus is not in your heart. You accepted Jesus for you in your heart. Jesus at the right hand of the Father in heaven. What you do have inside of you, who you do have inside of you, is the Holy Ghost of God. He leads and guides all ways, truth, righteousness. Now, during those days, I'm glad Jesus knows the hearts of men. I really am. I'm so happy about that. I am. But verse number 7 of chapter number 16 says, man looketh on the outward appearance. We live among men. Correct? Okay, follow me. This is one reason a newborn Christian should be baptized. As soon as possible, he should be baptized. Why? You say, well, God knows my heart. It's not God who wants to see it. Who looks upon a person when they get baptized? God knows the heart of a person when they're saved or not, right? But what happened is men look upon the outward appearance. So outward appearance holds some value. Follow me very carefully. What are you looking at? You're looking at the outward appearance. No. Why do ladies get dressed up? You are self-aware. Did I say that to myself? I get people right here that almost understand that. I want you to turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Would you do that for me, please? Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans, 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians chapter 3. 2 Corinthians chapter number 3. Church in Corinth was the most carnal, loose-living, worldly active church in all the Bible except maybe one Revelation. Okay? They did almost everything contrary to what Paul had taught them. And they were taking each other to court because none of us were doing it. They were coming to the Lord's Supper and bringing their groceries and dinner, and that was no big deal. They had all kinds of problems there. Half of them didn't believe in the resurrection. They ever had milk. I mean, they were in each other's throat all the time, like churches tend to do. Yet Paul calls them the saints at Corinth. Now, let me say this. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Why don't you look at verse number 2? These loose-living, carnal Christians, Paul says, ye are our epistle. That's not a female apostle. Well, that's probably Mrs. Epistle. This is a written message. An epistle is a written message. Okay? So watch what he says there. Ye, he's talking to the church of these people. Ye are our epistle. It's a written message. And then he goes on and says, watch, which is a known relative. Oh. So he didn't say, look, God knows your heart. That's an established fact. God knows your heart. God knows everything. So why did he bring this up? Because he was saying, men are watching you.
this isn't a good illustration of God. This is not what they need to see about Jesus Christ. So he is saying, look, you're like something that I have written. People think, is that what Paul taught you? You are a poem like this. And people say, is that what God taught you? Is this what God taught us? Is that what God taught us? You are our epistle, a written message, known and read of me. So God already knew it. What do others see in your life? I know this church because I know the generation. I know what's going on out there in churches and in Christianity and religion. Do you have the appearance that other Christians, other people should be following? I'm talking teenagers. I'm talking everybody. Lady, I'm talking to you. Sir, I'm talking to you. Teachers, platform people, I'm talking to you. These are not assistants. These are platform people, by the way. You say, Jesus knows my heart. And yes, that's true. But he left you down here after you're saved, not so he can see Christ in you, but that man can see Christ in you. Jesus already sees you. He knows he saved you. You belong to him. He's got that part down. Yet we keep saying, Jesus is my heart. Jesus, okay, yes, that's true. But he left you down here to influence other people, men, by what they see. Men cannot see your heart, men. So look at them. They cannot see your heart, sir. So why do we keep saying it? Because we're making an excuse for what men want to see. Okay, you follow me? Okay, I'm getting somewhere. Don't leave me. He could not see Christ. Could a person see Christ in you? Do other men see Christ in you? So you could get others to follow the Lord. That's why we're left here, right? So we went others to Christ, right? We take the gospel into the world. Is that right? We don't take the Bible into the world. Though the gospel is in the Bible, the whole Bible is not the gospel. We've made it so confusing. Old time preachers go, we need to believe the gospel. Okay, sure, I know what you're talking about. But according to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, the gospel is the death, burial, resurrection of Jesus Christ. That is what saves people. So where are lost people? They're not in the world. So the world has convinced us, keep your religion to yourself and in your church. So we're no longer taking that which wins the lost to Christ. After they get saved, church is for Christians to come and learn the Bible. Not the gospel again. I love hearing about the gospel. I preach on Jesus, how he died, and all those kinds of things. It touches my heart. I love to hear it. But now that I'm born again, Christian, I need to grow in the Lord, right? Grow in grace and knowledge. A man is not saved by cleaning up his life and doing good works. However, after a man is saved, you get that part? Very important. After a man is saved, he ought to clean up his life and do good works. After a man is saved, he ought to walk. Jesus knows my heart. I want you to turn to Titus, okay? You're in 2 Corinthians, the 4th. Timothy, Titus, Philemon, Hebrews. If you know where Hebrews is, go back 2 or 3 books and come right into Titus. Titus, chapter number 3, go to verse number 8. I always like people go, I just want to learn the Bible. Okay, go back to the Bible. Titus chapter number 3. Would you please look at verse number 8? Watch very carefully. This is a faithful saying, and these things I will that thou affirm how often? Constantly. Ready? They which have believed in God might be careful to maintain good heart. Did I just read that? What's the fact? Works. Oh. Let me see. This is a faithful saying, and these things I will that thou affirm constantly. Talking to a preacher, affirm constantly that they which have believed in God might be careful to maintain good works. Why? These things are good and profitable unto men, not you, other people. So he's saying, when you do good works, this is to their benefit. So they can't see my heart. Only God. God looks upon the heart. Man looketh upon the outward appearance. So what is the big hairy deal? God knows my heart. Yeah, but you're not God. Ma'am, I know you can read your husband's heart, but now you can't trust me. Okay. So what happens here is simply this. God said, okay, you live among men. Show them me among me. It's profitable for them, for you, to maintain good works. So I'm going to ask you, where do you live? God, I'm not trying to smoke. Where do you live? Simply saying, what are you looking at? You're looking at the outward here. Okay? You're looking at, oh, my child, in his heart, he makes work. Mom, you don't know that. we say that, but you really don't know that. We say that about other people. Oh, I know they did that, but I think they had good intentions. You're trying to read the heart. Only God could do that. Even the devil cannot read the thoughts and intentions or the eternal destiny. Only God can do that. Only God can do that. So we see it. Now, don't be offended. Let's say you go out on a farm and you see an animal on four little legs going like this, you know, and their tail's kind of curly, and they go, and they got mud all over them. What would you call that? What did you see? Okay. Now, I did it that way, so you wouldn't think I called your pig. That's right. When you see something on the ground slithering, when you see slithering, and the tongue is coming out, and when you get close, it tries to raise up its head, we call that a, what are you looking at? You don't know that snake's on. You don't know that snake's on. Right off the bat, you say, you're a pig. That's kind of rude. We see unholy and worldly, you call that unchristian. He said, you're judging. You didn't finish that statement. The Bible doesn't say thou shalt not judge. You can carry that. It's not carrying that. It says, judge not lest you be judged. Because as soon as I tell Hope that is wrong, what I'm saying is, she may not know what I know, but I do, because I just told her. That's why the Bible said, judge if I were you, because if you do, you'd be judged the same way. Why? Because you are saying, I don't know. Okay, we follow that now. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5, verse 16, let your light so shine before men. Is that what he said? Not for all he said at all. Let your light shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Men want to see Christ. This is why a lot of the unbelief, among many other things, they do not any longer see a difference between you and your Savior and them and what they believe. Honestly, on a Sunday morning, you wouldn't know anymore if a guy's going bowling, hunting, or going to church. You say, where's your Bible? Got it right there on my phone. There you go. Yeah, but the world doesn't know that. They think you're just texting somebody, looking at something you shouldn't be looking at. They don't know. So we have completely left men out of this. And excused ourselves by saying, God knows my heart. Man, sir, child, God knows your heart. By the way, watch this. Don't be fooling around like it, but God knows my heart. Hold it. God knows your heart. So that is true. Listen to me. Here there was a, Christians are expected to live by faith. They don't. Most of us don't. God understands that, so he gave us men to follow. When you hear a person say, I follow Jesus, I don't need men, they have no idea what they're talking about. I would say, we're supposed to live by faith, right? So why did he give us preachers? Us live by faith. Why did he give us a mom and dad? You children live by faith. Because he already knew most of us don't. We should. For example, the Bible said, be holy, for I am holy. Okay, I guess I'll do that. You know what he's saying? I am holy. Say it, strive to be perfect. But because you can't, don't just grab all the trust and say, never mind. No. Strive to be perfect. Strive to be holy. Strive to live like Christ. He didn't say it doesn't matter because you can't achieve it. So here's what we run into. You know about these two people. One guy by the name of Stanley, and one by the name of William. Ministered to great, great missionaries to Africa in places most people couldn't even reach. Stanley found it out one day. Stanley lived with him for some time. Now, here's a part of his testimony that most people do not know. I didn't know this. When Stanley went there, he approached Livingston, Stanley talking about himself in his own diary, approached himself and told people, I approached his life like the most infidel, which is just an atheist, you would find. No one said, I'm religious. I need to go find this person. So he went there, by his own testimony, he said, I went in Africa as prejudiced as the biggest atheist in London. But there came to me, ready, after long time reflection, you know what that means? After watching him. After long time, my sister, who's in heaven right now, Donna, about last year, right, January, and what she did, my sister finally got, my sister got saved from the family. But because of, once we came, because of loneliness, she Christmas house for my mom's getting ready to die. She lived with my sister. My sister would hear me talking to my mom. She was in the back of the room. My voice came in. Okay, it was true. My wife is saying, when you whisper, people hear you down there. And so my sister would be in the back room. Oh, she did. Oh, so she'd be back there saying, drinking my teeth. I wasn't talking to her, but you see where the Lord saved. That had become better with the way the unsaved life was. She finally got, she broke one day and hugged me and said, I'm so sorry, she apologized. Now I'm glad you all know this. And she said, for a long time, my sister. And then she said, this is what she said. You do not know who's watching. Well, that's my neighbor. I know, but the guy across the street is watching. You ever notice that? You go witness to, sometimes you're witnessing to three or four teenagers, and the most of them are teenagers. But this kid over here is. They all walk away, throwing the trash down, making fun, and this kid's standing right there. You walk into a house and you're talking to a mom. Somebody's over on the banister. And mom says, I want you to do it on the way up and go like this. Can you finish that? You have to understand they're watching you. They're watching you. They're not just listening. They also are watching. So Stanley got over there, and he said, I saw this salt. My sister got right above that thing. 30 years. 30 years. You know what she said? I need to know what you said. 30 years? Good grief. What a trial I was on. I didn't even know she's watching me. Now, so he said, he goes on, he said, I saw this solitary old man there and asked myself, on earth did he start that? I say it was like in the middle of the darkest part of Africa. Is he cracked or what? He said, well, watch this. This guy's crazy. What's he doing here? Why did he end up here? This is what he's saying. What is it that inspires him? He's watching this guy and wants to know why would a man do that? So he's captured an unsaved man's attention. What he saw. For months after we met, I found myself wondering at the old man carrying out all that the Bible said, leave all things in front of me. Stanley wants to get it to me. So, look at him. That's what he's doing. His good works captured Stanley's heart, not for Stanley's sake. Stanley didn't, it made no difference to whether he was watching or not. He lived for Jesus. And Stanley watched this whole thing. And he said this, little by little, his sympathy for others became contagious. I watched this guy. I couldn't believe what he was doing. My sympathy was aroused. Seeing his piety, no more just perceiving me, his gentleness, his zeal, his eagerness, and how he went about his business. I was converted. You see, Stanley could have said, then they get how I live over here. The natives run around with nothing. I thought I could too. This country, you watch the pictures. They're in white shirts. I'm talking about Africa. Yeah, one more couple. They were comfortable with nothing. So is that okay? Listen, Stanley thought, I know what Christianity and how to live it should be. So I'm going to natives when they get saved. I'm going to teach them how they should live. Dress, act, talk. And that's what he did. Stanley watched all this, and this is amazing. Look at this guy going about his work. It captured his heart by what he saw. He didn't say, I see his heart. He loves Jesus. That's not what he said. He said, I saw his work. The appearance is very important to God and man, and should be to we that are Christians. Look, I told you, I was wearing slippers. I felt like I wasn't dressed up. I don't care what I had on, wearing slippers, I thought, I should be at home, my feet kicked up, watching a movie or something. I think it's a new pair of people I'm talking about. You may say, I have faith. I may say, I have genuine faith, and I'll prove it. I want you to go, if you would, to James, right after Hebrews, if you're in Titus, go forward about two or three books. Right after Hebrews, you'll see James, go to James, chapter number 2. You may say, I have faith. If you have genuine faith, prove it to me. Watch this. Besides that, I can prove nothing to you. Oh, I beg to differ. Oh, I beg to differ. If you're a Christian, you do. By the way, should we not be able to put our Christianity in the world? I mean, shouldn't the world expect better out of us than they do themselves? I mean, shouldn't it be easy for us to live in such a way that the world says, oh, I want what you've got? We have sidestepped the whole thing by simply saying, I have Jesus in my heart. Nobody, no human being can see your heart. You can't see it. Go to James chapter number 2, verse number 18. Are you there? Now, here's James. I love the book of James. Very practical. Here's what he says. Yea, a man may, what's this word? Say. Okay? Now, he puts it in the answer. He just says, this man says, thou hast faith, and I have work. So he looks at James is presenting an argument. Oh, you're telling me I have faith, and he's like, thou hast, that he has faith, and I have work. It's okay. I got that part. And I said, show me thy faith without work. People who say, see my heart. I have faith in Jesus. Should be easy to prove you have faith in God's children. Show me your faith. So James turns the thing back around. He says, show me your faith without works, right? Impossible. James, who wrote this book, turns the whole thing around, and here's what he says. I will show you my faith by my works. You know what he's saying? You say you have faith? It should be showing. I'll show you my faith by my works. So we have just decided today we'll rewrite our own Bible, and you'll just have to trust me. I'm sorry, I can't do it. I cannot read your heart. And so these are the things I'll show you my faith by my word. I have a question for you. What are you looking at? No, what are you looking at? That's what we're doing. We're in my head for that. We're in my head. We're in the emphasis of the words. Right, Ben? What are you looking at? We as Christians say, look at that from the second. She's dressed like a street worker. True. But even here, I've asked these ladies to do it. I said, well, you look at your young man. The young one don't kiss. I do. Older one don't kiss. I would never do that. Yes, you do. I bless you. You want to see their heels, what dress they got on, how they fix their hair. Yeah, you do. I watch them walk down all you don't kiss. If that could be good or bad, if you're judging them to criticize, it's bad. If you look at it, you don't know how to do that. If it's good, that would be a good thing, right? But I've asked before, and the younger women in here are going to get it, right? The older women are going to get it, right? Now, what are you looking at? Look at his cute. Oh, you never said something like that. I said that about a woman since you were born. That girl is never going to know that woman. Said that about to you, we look at others and say, look at that, look at that, look at that. How can we look at that? But when it comes to you, what? Right, right? Right? Then we say, does it make sense? Makes sense? We excuse us and look at others and make judgments. While at the same time, we don't judge. But we do, everybody does. My Christian friend, listen to me carefully. We are showing the world what we believe and what we do. By what you do, not what you say. By what you do, I remember I used to work for money. I worked in a brake shoe factory. I worked for a brake shoe factory. And one day, they used to have these things that would go in your hands and were chained by a cord to the machine. So every time this press came down like this to put rivets and brake shoes, and when they filled up my roof of brake shoes, they said, no. They don't do that anymore. They just throw them on. But they used to put rings and braces. And you had a quota. So you had to take two pieces of metal, brake shoes, put them on the machine. They had little forks that you had to put them on there. Then you had to take the pad and put that on there, line it up, put it on there. And as soon as you hit a button, it would go banging like that. And you put those rings in there. Well, as soon as this came down, these are supposed to be the hands back. Forks. So if this comes down, your hands go back. You really have to pay attention. He said, "No, do it all that." Like, well, not always. So there was this godly fear. Going the rest of my life like this. So one day I was working, and it's all peaceful, and I'm working on it, and my head will look up, and the sky's going up. So I got out of here. Back even before that state. And walked over, and he went, watch. Here's what he said. I saw you looking at him. I said, what? He said, yeah. You looked that way. I said, look at him. He said, I watched him. He watched me all day long, trying to find something he could say. You think you can walk through this world with that man? Ladies and gentlemen, they are watching you to see if you have genuine faith. If I were to follow you, would it be good for me? If I followed you, would I have what you have? If I did what you did, notice not one time I said what you had in your heart. You know what? He didn't know what I had in my heart. You look up like this. I saw what you were looking at. He was trying to find something that he could nail me with to say, I know you want to lose this. You're being watched. And rightfully so. The world should be able to look at you and say, that's a Christian. No? Because of this, God is always and has been concerned about the way that his children appear to the world. Children are a direct reflection of their father. Children are a direct reflection of God. We are not saved and then left here by God to fit in, to cohabitate, or get along with this world. This is what preachers are teaching. We have actually said church is for sinners. It is not. The gospel is for sinners. They're out there. Church is, by definition, ekklesia, which is a Greek word which means it is a called out assembly. So I'm called out to assemble in a place, God's people, for a purpose of taking the gospel out and teaching God's people here. You know what we turn into? We've had people come here and they like the preaching, which is shocking to me. They like the people here, which wasn't shocking to me at all. If this church isn't friendly, don't even leave another church because they're all dead. It's the friendliest church I've ever been in. But they say it's not right. But anyway, the person said, I like the preacher. I like the people. I like the building. But the music just didn't make me feel it. We have exchanged the learning Bible, the learning doctrine, learning about God. Said you're making fun of other people. I am making fun of them. Because of what I see. So I'm going to take a judgment. What I see is that I'm starting with this. And the other person said, what are you looking at? He said, preacher, you're looking at no, follow that. What are you looking at? Same thing. Listen to me. We are the salt of the earth, not sugar. No place in the Bible says, we are the sugar of the world. Well, who would you say? Who even says that? Do you know what salt does? Have you ever eaten a bag of potatoes? No, you're a healthy one. Ever eaten a bag of potatoes and had a cup? Didn't that salt feel good? Oh, well, that's wonderful. Ooh, I think I'll do that. You didn't do that. You went, oh, right in the cut. So when something is open and wounded, salt doesn't make it feel good. Right? This world is a putrefaction of filth and sin and heading in the wrong direction. We want everybody to like us and if they don't, we want the preacher to change. Preacher, you need to change. The evangelist of my family, she doesn't like you at all. I understand that. You were walking this way and this immovable object was in front of you. Called Pastor Bill. And he said, get out of my way. You need to change. I said, no, can't do that. See, I didn't like the Bible. I didn't establish this church. I worked for the Lord. That's all I do. So here's what you have to understand. Our job is to change men for Christ, not just make the world look better. J. Vernon McGee used to say all the time, I can't believe he's now, but he's through the Bible with J. Vernon McGee. I call this the same Sunday. And he would say, we are not here to clean up the carpet. We're here to clean up the carpet. Folks, we're getting ready to go to heaven. We're not changing this world so Jesus can finally say, okay, it's good enough, I can come back. No, that's what he's going to do when he comes back. We're not establishing the kingdom. The kingdom right now is in the hearts of men. We are trying to get Jesus into their heart. That's called salvation. And by that one day, we're going. It's called the rapture. That word is not in the Bible, but means a snatching away, a taking away. When that happens, when the two flutes, we're going to scoot. You got it? Okay, so. If you're not saved, you're not going, so what are we doing here in the meantime? We're trying to win others to Christ. So what are you looking for? Number one. That's not getting the message. Number one. Do your children give you attention? It's amazing to me how many years ago, I got saved in 1972, beginning of 1972. One more year to 50 years. Wow, I feel tired. I'm trying to say that. 50 years, I have seen things change and change and change, and they're not doing this. They're doing this. You got bored in just this song you're looking at. And you wonder why I made judgments on you because I've seen these patterns. I've seen these directions. You think this is the first time? There's nothing new under the sun. Nothing new under the sun. I thought this would have had this weirdest thought this morning. I thought back in the days of the hippie, when you would have said, I'll never cut my hair on you. Isn't it just like God to create more bald people than I was doing? I looked in the mirror this morning and I thought to myself, you don't look bald. I don't want to cry. Seriously, I don't want to look like you bald. Here's what I didn't want to either, preacher. I just thought, wouldn't it be just like God? Everybody's wondering, he's looking at their hair and growing it long and greasy and like that. And the girls thought it's so cool. You know, like the hair, you look at the effeminate and how you can control it. Well, that's a smack of the hair. Remember the ICP got called Fantastic Stick Men? Go back up on me now. But that's what, but wouldn't it be just like God? Maybe 2 years later, you have all the bald people in the room. Didn't you have a front one time? Didn't you? Come to me. You had dreadlocks, I know that. Didn't you change it to a front? Yes, come on. I can't do this with you. Do you remember that? You just had a hair and you walked the house. Back in the 60s, I was in the 70s, or the 60s, I was on the West Coast. You do? Yeah? I can't find my consent. I don't know about that stuff. It was so cool. That was different. Oh, my God. And they would walk in the door, they'd walk in. They're embarrassed. Am I right? Am I right there? And I thought, and then they put on that black sleeve, and it was stuck. It was absolutely gorgeous. Now look at me. I'm really, this is not fair, right? You can do it with people all again. I'll never lose my hair. I said that. Oh, you did. I didn't even want to look at the back. People take pictures. So what are you taking from that angle? Yeah, right? It's like, yeah. No, I keep that picture, didn't I? That's all I know how to do with pictures. Can I take them? Enjoy it. That's all I know. You take a picture from the back, I'm believing. I'm not keeping it. It looks like a spotlight or something. What is it the unsaved see in your child? you think you're saved? What are others seeing in your children? When you did not get done, you must have something to do. That's why I was talking to Quaker Sarah this morning. They came here as teenagers. Now, Sarah said, you have been persuaded. They have said, you know, that you still have like that teenager, don't you? I'm telling you, they still don't care. The one they didn't know was your mom and dad bought the chunkers for you. That's what she said. That one of these little chunkers, which was being back in the same room as the little chunkers, and they said, the person they looked at. And they would absolutely look at it. You would not. See, I'm not trying to go your direction. You're coming my direction. Maybe invite their mom. Mommy got saved. Mommy got saved, and here's what she said. And I told her, I said, why? She said, I had to go to the bathroom. I said, you have to go. I said, Mrs. Stover, she said, I invited my husband. I said, you need to hear this guy. Did it right? You need to hear this guy. And he said, why? Her prayer's worth? No. You didn't hear a guy like this guy. But he came here, made a big old railroader, you know, had the whole railroad beds on, and the beard down to here, and the hair was not long, and he stayed out in the parking lot. So I walked up to him and said, Pastor Bell, how are you? I heard about you. I said, good, come on in. He got saved. And now I'm home and dad and family. And really nice people from this last year. By the way, their family did just not work here. And they did cut out the girls, the dad and all that kind of stuff. So please stop and see them. What are you looking at? Are you looking? Are people looking at your children with a lack of respect? All kids are like that. Their rebellious attitude towards right and good, like the unsaved kids. Is it not supposed to be a difference in other works than their works? Murmuring, complaining. By the way, that's one of the biggest sins that got Israel in trouble. Every time they turned around, murmuring, complaining. God chastises them. We think that's our right to do, right? To murmur, to outside, share with people. Whining and pouting all the time. Is this what your kids do? Their hairstyles, their music, their talk, just like you see in the unsaved world. That's it, never happened. Other kids will be training to tell you what you should do. This is the way a Christian child should go. Well, I think, sorry, that's not in the Bible. I think it's not in the Bible. God did not take your case. God did not say anything. Somewhere we thought this was really cool. Put out flyers in the neighborhood because we want to help them. I'm not here to help the neighborhood. Do you sound odd compared to what I'm saying? I'm here to win people in the neighborhood. You're here to change anything. So if you're, I'm trying to get the world for you to make you more like Jesus so we can attract them to start following the truth. So what we have here is this. Hairstyle just like the world, but you say they have a good heart. What are you looking at? What are you looking at? Only God knows the heart. Man, look at the outward appearance. Are your children reflecting Christ in the world? In Psalm 127, in verse number 3, the Bible says, children are inheritance of no man, but of the Lord. The world, this state right here, will tell you that your children are wards of the state. They will tell you, you don't know how to pray. Our God will take care of them. I said, no, they're my kids. I'm going to do them. And on the other hand, if they're raising them right, they're still my church. They are a heritage of the Lord. God gave them to you for Him. God said, I need children to raise up for me. Here, that one's for you. That girl's for you. Those six are for you. In Proverbs chapter 22, verse number 6, train up a child in the way he should go. They're God's kids, and we need to train them up for Him. Christian children outwardly should reflect the teaching of their heavenly Father. Not their earthly Father, their heavenly Father. Unless your parents are telling you to do something absolutely against the Bible, God says, obey your parents. It does not say, understand your parents. It says, obey your parents. The more children obey, the more they'll understand. all of us know that's true, because as we got older, maybe you had a baby, maybe mommy wasn't around when you were growing up, and you thought, hey, I wonder what I'm supposed to do. If you had a mom or dad, you always do it. Like, well, I guess I saw my dad use this saw, and what he, I'm reflecting back on what dad taught me. You understand what I'm saying? So what happens here, the Bible, when you tell your children to sit down, do it. I've watched good Christian parents. No, I don't. But I do, sit down. I say sit down. Would you sit down? I'm not going to tell you again to sit down. Sit down, they told me again. And I said, and they just keep doing it. Jumping, he looked at us, I don't believe this. And so what do you need to do to that young kid? It's not acting. Yet the other side of the journey is it. They said, what's wrong with him? Here's the big thing. He's not hurting anything. I said, he's hurting anything. He's something. What are you looking at? The child who will not obey neither father or mother will one day not obey father. I always like to think about, no, it tells me what to do. You know where they end up? Prison. Being told what to do. You're going to go to the bathroom now, you're going to go to bed now, you're going to eat now. Nobody goes to this world doing what you want. You're either going to do what the world and you think, or you're going to do what Christ thinks and what he wants. In the old days, a naughty child was straightened up from being bent over. A naughty child was straightened up by being bent over. Listen to me, mommy. A naughty child was straightened up by being bent over. The Bible says that foolishness is bound in the heart of a child. It's tied in there. Ready for this? But the rod, and then something's wrong in here. Let's get that out. But the rod of correction. See, we keep talking about circumstances. Let's talk Bible. What does the Bible have to say? When you look at other children, do you not make judgments on their kids? Yes, you do. You are here. Okay, ready for this one. Now, don't. Did the clock stop? Nope. Ready for this? Now, in those seats, right underneath, if you'll reach way underneath the door, seat back. You can pull those around, snap them in, draw them real hard. That way, when you get ready to run into truth, you'll be fine. Wife. Hey, you're laughing already? I haven't got started. Wife. See me at Christmas. Wife, do you give the appearance of a Christian? You say, Richie, you don't know me. You're right, I don't. That's all I can say. Please understand. Why should other women desire to be like you? And here's what we say. Unless it comes out of yours, I think so. Although I just have such a great heart for children. I can see that. Please understand what I'm going with this. They are not looking at your good intentions, what you believe, what you may have in your heart. Man looketh on the outward. I'm not talking about your husband right now. What is the world looking at? I'm just showing you how the world has changed. Look, during the hippie days, I'm telling you, look at me, look at me. You ready for this? No judgments. Go back and look at some of the 60s things that were happening. Women were supposed to be church and unchurched. Do you see what you said? If it's above here and show your fire, it's mine. He said, that's my choice. It's true. But are you reflecting somebody that I don't know that is in your fire? I have texted some of these young ladies and my husband send them how pretty they look and how proud I am of them and what they're doing. Every one of them texts back and says, because it's not true. Every one of them says, because it's not true. So, in other words, you're watching them. You have to understand, my men, which is 15, men, which is 16, as he told me the other day, I love climbing trees. I love climbing trees. How in the world do you go from where boys' tennis shoes, boys' pants, and slippers, she had five brothers, how did she end up being a lady like that? You want to know how to raise kids? You want to know how to have a good marriage? You want to know what to do with your finances? You say it's all in the Bible? Say you don't know it, do you? Yes, it is. Much, much more than that. What about the slit all the way at the back of your dress? What about the see-through, low plunging neck? Like, you know your body works for that. Not for other people. Not for other people. Man looking on the outward appearance. That see-through boss, that bad attitude, that no smile. Somebody said the other day, Miss Bob, what's all you ever do is love? When we get home from that skin. You wouldn't know if you agreed or disagreed. Now, you may be doing it. I'm telling you, you don't agree. You say, no, I agree. It looks young. I can't read your mind. I don't know your heart. So, if you can wake up and you can go like this, you can go like that. You can smile about your life and praise the preacher. I was saying, brother, Tom Beck's wife wasn't here. She's got the most pleasant. And when she says, Mr. Priest, you know, she says back here in court time, she says, she's got a real deep depth of it. And she just looks at this energetic face to me, like, you tell her something. And I'm thinking, when I'm looking at a crowd, I'm preaching, that's disappointing. And I'm looking for certain people. She's one of them. And I look at her, and I'm just saying, look, socks is another. You talk to socks, and you say, preacher, do you like to decorate the day? Don't you just love it? And then she gets so carried away. What's your husband, honey, buddy? That's so cute. And so cute. Don't lie about that, it's great. Aww. But that's the Asian statement I'm trying to do today. Oh, he's Cambodian. She's Asian. What are you looking at? What are you looking at? It's the previous part of Asian. That's what I'm looking at. We have Islanders and Mexicans and white people and hillbillies. Those are the people I'm talking about. God cares what others see in your children. God cares what others see in the wife. God cares how you run your home. God cares. People are walking. I got a neighbor. I was in the Navy, and I haven't been out to work in my yard. Watch it. You think I'm kidding you. A nice guy, we talk to each other once in a while. He was, I think he was. He invited me to church. He just has me. And he told me, he said, come over when you were there. When you were there, they knew this. Nothing. And he told them to this. Where's Georgia? So he calls me. He says, where's Georgia? And of course, they thought, Georgia. Oh, that's that. And he said, he's normally, I'm missing being out in the yard fixing things up all the time. I never watched the last week ago. But he's watching. He knows I'm a Christian. That's not good enough. Now, he sees my works, even to the point of cleaning my yard. Keeping things that you don't think so? Fellas, men that work like men that work. We can point out all the ladies scumbag and all that. They have every excuse in the world on why they can't do it, why I can't do that. But a man that works, he can spot another man that works. He doesn't even know a man that doesn't like you. Because he works. Don't you just despise a lazy man? I'm thinking about that. This is what's killing me. It's not my foot. I can't work. These guys are walking up and down the hallway, working out all over the place. I can't even keep up with her. I can't keep up with my wife walking right now. She's one that corner. She'll walk on the corner. How aggravating it is. Why? Because I'm a man. work. That's what I do. I work. I like to work. I'm all these things. I like to work. That's what I do. That's what I've done for almost 15 years as a Christian. That's what I do. Before that, I was in the military. You know how that means, okay? Man, the way you cut your hairstyle, should other women follow? What is with the multiple talk of the women? I was up for nothing to check. I don't get this. You have beautiful dark hair, beautiful blonde hair, but you want green, purple, blue, all at the same time. I never understood that. If you have beautiful blue, that would be blue. I look at the solo girls because they're Mexican. And their hair is thick and dark and long. I don't think it's pretty. That's pretty. Abigail is sitting there. Abigail's George's wife. And her hair was all the way down here, and just beautiful, dark, smooth Mexican hair. That's even for its Mexican hair. And I used to look out to her, and I loved her hair. That was beautiful. And she didn't try to finish the fix. She said, beautiful. One day, things up to here. After she got married, I knew. I said, Abigail, soon as you get married, no preacher did that. Oh, that's up to here. Now, pretty soon, it'll be blessed, and she'll have her initials at the side. No trip. Right? And then she'll say this, don't you love my hair? Nobody's allowed to say no. If your hair is purple, I'm not going to love your hair. If I look at you, what's happening? It's all safe, right? We're done. Right? You're not allowed to say no. If my hair sticks straight up in the air and points forward, and all this is shaved off, if you love your hair, you know what you want me to do? You're forcing me to leave your body, which I cannot do. I'm going to have to tell you, no, it looks stupid. But I'm not supposed to say that, right? Because everybody, I have kids. I was telling my son. Someone has to do this. And it looks so wrong. And the reason I wear long sleeve shirts almost all the time, kids used to walk up to me like this. What's that? I wasn't sure what to say. So I told him what I was thinking. Where is that? It's stupid. I did that when I was like 12 years old, 13 years old. That's stupid. I was at a bank one time and I was signing something. I had a hard time getting it, trying to cover up the business. Long time ago. And the person behind me was writing something down. I said, well, this time I had money. No, thank you. And the girl behind me said, I like your tattoos. What's it? You're supposed to say, oh, thank you. They said, what? I don't know what to say after that. See, we're all in this rhythm of talking certain ways. Love your hair. When somebody goes like this, why don't you say, we don't know what to say. I like your tattoos. It's stupid. Why do you like them? See, the world wants you in their rhythm. And when you don't do that, so this is what, please forgive me for saying, I have two daughters, I have a wife, I have a lot of women around here, my wife has two. Why do you want to take that natural beauty that God gave you and see that? Then you get old and go like this, my mom, mom. Trust me, keep that middle right here. The screaming around your house, what does that cause? But you don't know the neighbors know summer's coming. Windows up. I don't care if you're a preacher or not, you're going to. Really? Really? And you go, hey, you want to come to church with me? Why? Why do they want to do that? Right? Doors open. Wham! Oh, hi. Really? And then you witness that, hey, you were having to invite your neighbor to church today. That's the reason Christians don't invite their neighbors anymore. No, honey, we can't remember that. Remember that day? Yeah, I remember that day. Drinking, smoking, skipping church. I threw that one in there, too. Hey, I wonder if Margaret, I'll help you next time. Margaret's still home. Don't see mom and dad, sir. They're watching. I'm just saying, they're watching. Your house and your yard, the world and others are looking at you. Okay, ladies, we're done. Men, cinch it up. No, I'm only putting that one in because we're a bunch of small details. we just like, at least we can aim them if we want to. Oh, good, not one. Woo, dude, that's great. Way to go, lady. In all my life, I've never seen so many bad saying bad examples for the family. I've done this thing for 750 years, so I'm not making this up from this year. You daddies, why should your wife? Gives you more, you have to do more. What should you have? Well, she doesn't find it simple to do this. My wife doesn't know what to do. She 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 doesn't know what to do. This whole empty blessing, I'm all for it. We need to step through it. Actually, we had a lot of cereal. Just going to find out. Milk? I don't know if I'm going to drink milk. I don't know if it's too bad. I don't know if I can. When the kids are home, we never had milk. I can't go and get oysters. Oysters is like, you know what? Now I get sick. You want to love it when your kids are gone. You'll be able to go on vacation for the first time in your life. Ha! Ha! That's a lot of fun. And the kids go, Mom, why didn't you do that? We're home. Good for it. So I said, I didn't want to take it. That's not a vacation. He just come back from a couple of days. You only farmed out the kids. Hey, you guys are watching for me for a couple of days. We're getting out of here. It's kind of fun, though. He said, I want my kids always to stay here. Maybe you need to get right with God. That's what I tell you. No one rules your life. Sir, your boss doesn't. His angels are dead. Your self-made doesn't. Your preacher doesn't. Nobody comes. Oh. Including God. What? You want your life to submit to you. You don't submit to you. Why should the world want to have what you say you have? Sir, listen to me. Why would they want to marry you? It's a good question. It's a good question. Everybody struggles. You know, I've taught on this. You've heard me teach on this. But why would they, even on your best day, want what you have? Seriously. Sir, why would somebody that just got married want your advice? I'm sorry the world cannot see your heart, but your job takes first place in your life, just like the lost world says. I'm going to say something right now. You don't attend church when you're supposed to because of what something's wrong with you. And it will continue to be wrong. You'll find out the more you make excuses why you can't go to church, the more you'll make excuses why you're not. Church is a vital part of your existence. Young people, look at me. You cannot make it as a Christian without assembling yourselves together in the Lord's house. That is a command of God because He, look, this whole laptop thing, we run this whole watch me online stream and stuff. I'm glad we have older people that simply cannot be here. We have people that are so sick, they cannot get out of bed. I'm glad you're watching. Glad you're here. I don't understand this. 42 different nations in any given time are watching our service. So please step down, folks. I think we have people to say that. You say, preacher, what? I don't know. I don't know. And by the way, we come down here and you think we're all weird and we're doing this and we're doing stuff. And you go home and stuff like that. And that means I love you. I love you. Everybody signs that. My wife signs. I'm signing. So when she signs, no one. We do. And so we do. We're waiting to take her home. They text and written and said, I love that so much. So we gathered down here and everybody's Christian people there. I had visitors like this though. They're waving back. Oh, that's sweet. Hi, how are you? Sir, when I'm preaching like this, why don't you smile? You think by showing your disagreement you won't change the world? I will. Right to you. I went after someone right when you were born, wasn't it? I had no intentions there. See, I don't change so the world will come to you for a moment. We do this, you come to be a part of us. That's what we realize here. You're not in love with your own wife, as the Bible says. You mean even going in the direction, not where we're walking? Because I'm saying, we can't say, I know. Christ takes precedent. By the way, if Christ was present in your life and in your home, you would have that problem. Now, everybody has facts. Everybody has those kinds of things. But this thing about a woman finally taking her stand, and if you don't follow me, I'm never coming back again. You put it, that's what, basically what Eve did with her home, and he was to miss. He loved that woman. She may be like this in the end and compared to her. I just came to me. Well, when she ate the food, he showed up. He said, look what I've done. I'm going to get down here. The Bible says she was deceived. Adam said, you know what he did? Why would he give up his walk with God? Look at the mess we're in. By the way, you do that now. You're going to get your way so you can go. Kneel. Get up. I'm just kidding. Go ahead. Go ahead. That's what you want. You're not going to be happy with this. See, we don't want a man fully sold out to Jesus because that's just weird. This is you over there all the time. First of all, there's a balance set between four and five. You're out of balance. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25, husband, love your wives even as Christ also loved the church. Jesus does not compromise truth to stay in love with us. Following your wife and giving up truth is not right. Now, you young men listening, when you get into this trap, listen to me. So, put your ear in the mouth. Oh, yes, I do too. She said right back there. The whole time we were that close to the door, ask her. I went to church every time. I didn't know what they were preaching on. I cried the whole time I was there. I was almost on the altar from beginning to end, begging God for my wife while she stayed at home. Why? Because God told me to. God said, don't forsake the assembly. We give all that up, hoping to win. Sir, if you're ever going to win that woman back, you have to follow the Lord, or what you get back, you're going to be in an area you don't even like. And she's sitting right there, shaking her head. Yes, you're going about right, wrong. And right is never wrong. Right is never. You cannot go back. Colossians chapter 3, verse number 19. Husbands, love your wives and be not bitter against them. closest picture that the world can show people of our relationship with Christ. She doesn't mind. She just got a laugh. What do you want her to do? She's in public. Just make fun of her. You want to start crying? First of all, I don't think it's funny. Don't ever do that. Don't ever come. Don't ever make fun of her. Don't ever criticize her. Are you unthankful with what God has given you? Like the world that you can say is Daddy, men, do you give the appearance of Christian? Does the world see Christ in your life and your work? You say, yes, God knows that I love him. I know, but men don't. Men don't. Look, I'm so in love with the Lord. Look at me. Miss Sarah, can you move forward a little bit to your right? That's my wife. She said, I'm praying. I don't know. How do I adjust that right there? I want to know. Jesus comes first. But Jesus made you a man. You step way out on it, Jesus said. Jesus made you for a man, not for children. You have children. He's your husband. Thank you, Ben. What a big way of doing, man. We've had at least two amens. But somebody, your wife's not even here. Go ahead. Get some fruit. Say amen. It'll be all right. Robert Ingersoll. Ingersoll was an atheist through and through. One day she received a mail to the mail to her, opened it up, and it was a book that Ingersoll had written. It was called An Attack on the Bible. On the Friday, if you can't remember what it was, because you didn't see it, on the Friday, it's on the inside. He said, if all Christians had lived like you said, perhaps this book would never have been written. He said, do you know the word of God says, I tell you, how Christians should be? Sometimes they're wrong. What they say? Christians shouldn't smoke a drink. Where did you get that from? You shouldn't dress like that. These are sin law people. They don't. That's really cool. I mean, I'm going to the church because you're dressed the way you want to. Where's that at? If I got somebody, I've got a missionary in Africa telling people we're at one certain time. Seriously, the way you dress on Sunday morning, are you going to see me? He said, after this. Okay, in the meantime, put it on the same time. You don't know where. It's not the tie's fault, it's your fault. I'll guarantee you, on Sunday morning, if anybody's up there, you don't come to me. They won't say, hey, look, Pastor Bell's getting ready to go bowling. Does this look like I'm getting ready to go bowling? What does your zero set do? Does this look opinion, are the intentions behind? Does this look like a Lord Bowman? Does this look like a Lord Fisher? This kind of looks like Lord Bowman today's society. I'm going to church. I'm going before the Savior, my King, Almighty God. And I hold you to God. He said, He knows the heart. Yeah, and he also looks like a kid. There's all kinds of Bible for him. I'll answer the question. See, either glorifies God or does not glorify God. Answer this. Take your seat. Are you saved? You do know that when you get saved, the Bible says you are not your own, you've been bought with a price. You have no right to do what you want. You have no right to believe what you want. You have no right to wear what you want to wear. But I'm a reflection of my Heavenly Father. I say, what do you want? Is this okay with you? Such a bad relationship with our Savior, we're making up what we think is okay with him. To look for this with ourselves in the church. Often we'll think these laser light shows, smoke, really? I don't mean, I don't know what I care about. You understand what I'm saying? What are we doing? What is this all about? What are we trying to accomplish here? You go back a few years ago, we had teenagers coming in and get teenagers. So you have lives that you have no words. We actually got called and we said that we can't do the things. We heard that's right. But they start going between us. I'm sorry, you can't do the things. We've had moms call over. What kind of church is this? Judging people and telling them they can't wear clothes. What if that's all they got? Man, look, I know that's not what she's got. We are being almost overwhelmed with people. But what they don't want to do, we need to discuss it like this. What is this problem? Maybe, sir, I've been preaching this for 15 years. It's not me, it's me, it's me, it's me. Look, I got a lady right there shaking her head, but now it's me. The wife of a pastor, who came here when she was a teenager, she said to me, yes, nothing has changed. You changed, they changed, him changed. The Bible hasn't changed. We need to adjust us to the Bible, not the Bible to us. I'm talking about you, sir. I'm talking about you, ma'am. I'm talking about your kids. I'm talking about our families. I'm talking about our finances. I'm talking about our church. Are you saying? Here I go with this experience. Now, I'm so glad I'm saying about your church. I saw my wife last night. We're looking at all these pictures tonight. That's Luke Moreland. I looked at this picture. I looked at this picture. I looked at this picture and looked at all these pictures. What? I don't believe this, guys. I don't believe it. Who would ever thought that would happen? With you resisting things like that. The Bible works. Everything God says is true. I just decided. God is my sister. I believe, like Paul, all things pass away. It's gone. Oh, I know that. I don't know anyone. I don't believe that way. I don't act that way. I don't say that way. I don't do that way. And we had 175 years. Hey, brother, glad you made it. turned and looked at me and said, "You were with that Seventh-day Adventist Church that you were with that Seventh-day Adventist Church." And I said, "Since I came home, I have said, I'm not a right hand coming from me." Then they just kind of scared of me. This is what Christians do with people who stretch out to live with. Why do you like that? You're strange. No one is. Why should that be strange among even other Christians? Are you saying? Is there a day, has there been a day in your life when you personally have received Jesus Christ as your Savior? I ask if you knew about it. I ask if you have ever received Him as your personal Savior. If you haven't, dear brother, do you understand right now? It's not your choosing whether to go to heaven or hell. You're already condemned already. John chapter 3, verse number 18. You are condemned already. You're not going to heaven. You're condemned already. And it tells us why. Because thou hast not received the only begotten Son of God. Because if you don't have my Son, you're already condemned. He is your only hope. If you're saved, just listen. You need to start living so people can see. So much